Surprised by hope? Are you surprised by the news, the good news of Jesus' second coming? As this four-week preaching series continues today, we're going to focus on Jesus' return, the cycle of the good news of the gospel, his second coming. And today, please let me share again some of my experience in this journey and all that. In 1976, I married this lovely young lady, Julie Stout. There we are, standing just right before our wedding time in the Methodist church there in my hometown. And my mother, the full-time Lutheran mother named Grace, was just a little bit disappointed when I became a Methodist. I liked being Lutheran, but I also liked being Methodist, and I loved my wife, and it was her church, so it just kind of all made sense. And one reason I really liked being a Methodist, besides the great people that were there, I'm friends now, is that they had a 1904 Tracker organ. It was built by the Tracker Organ Company, known as Verney Organ Company of Mason City, Iowa. It was an amazing instrument, built before electricity. It had 19 ranks. It was the largest organ that company ever built. It was the end of the Romantic music period, that classical history period. It was an amazing thing to play. Because back then, as I remain today, I'm an organ geek. I love organs. I love what they do for worship. And sometime you ought to just take a chance and come to the early service and hear Gail. She's fantastic. I quickly became the organist at the Methodist Church. Not long after my joining, though, a new pastor came to town, and he joined us in ministry, and he was disappointed almost from the very beginning by the low attendance and the lack of participation and so many things. So he planned a Bible study at his home. And I felt kind of sorry for him. And so we decided maybe we should go. There we went, Julie and I, barely in our 20s, went that night, and he showed a film. The film was entitled A Thief in the Night. It both angered us and scared us just a little. End times movie. That kind of stuff is known as eschatology. Eschaton is the end time stuff. Logos is the study of in the end times. But this was a film that we felt went too far. It sought to scare us that we'd be ready for when the time came that we'd be swept away up into heaven in the rapture. It's that almost every generation, there's a fascination with what will come next, the end times. How popular are zombies, right? Movies and books, YouTube, social media of every type, you'll find it out there. And that movie centered itself in one short phrase of Jesus, like a thief in the night, and a couple sentences on the Apostle Paul about the rapture. You know, I'm kind of relieved this morning because in both services, there have been some very fine Christians here, and I was kind of worried that maybe it happened and I didn't notice. You were watching, weren't you? Because last Tuesday, May 14th, it was scheduled to be the rapture. It's all over the internet, Facebook, YouTube. It was supposed to happen. You'd be taken up into heaven if you're a good Christian. It didn't happen. People that spend time in the scripture do all kinds of calculations. This time they took the number of years that the nation state of Israel has existed, and now it ended in its 70th year just now, and they realized then that that would make God act, make the year of the Jubilee number, and so God would certainly have to bring the rapture, right? Wrong. No one was taken. No one was left behind. But yet the predictions just keep coming. I noticed yesterday there's already new predictions a few years down the road. Try to be ready for that, will you? Again and again, producers keep making movies. Not so long ago, another epic motion picture, a big picture was made called Left Behind. It was based in part on the incredibly popular book series Left Behind. These books were written by the evangelical preacher, pastor Timothy LaHaye. LaHaye promoted 70 years of ministry, by the way, of a rapture, that when Jesus-believing Christians would be taken up, and those of you who are not such great believers, you'd have to stay behind in a total mess. That book series sold nearly 80 million copies. Yeah, that concerns me just a little bit. So today I'm going to play for you a 2-minute trailer of this Left Behind movie. Please don't watch the whole thing. This will be enough. Left Behind. It might scare you a little bit.
Hi, Mom.
Chloe, welcome home.
So is everything set for Dad's surprise party?
We got called into work.
Can I buy you a coffee?
I'm waiting for someone. My dad.
Hi, sweetheart.
Hey.
Welcome aboard PanCon flight 257 to London. My time today will be 6 hours and 30 minutes.
I love you. People from all over this plane have simply vanished.
Chris, let me in! Chris!
And believe me, so do I, and I'll do my best to get them.
I heard some doctors talking. It's not just here. It's all over the world.
One of these days, the sky's gonna break.
Chloe, are you okay?
Yeah, Mom and Raimi, they're both gone.
One of these days, the mountains are gonna fall into.
You took them to protect them from the darkest time.
History of this world.
The God my mother talked about would never do something like this.
We all have a right to know if we're gonna die. We're gonna die.
I just really need you to know how much I love you, no matter what happens.
Dad?
It's like the end of the world.
One of these days, the sky's gonna.
Are you ready? Don't worry about it. Did they really expect us to believe that God would take this beautiful creation, human beings God loves with everything, and leave it in that kind of a mess? I don't think so. And you know, you maybe didn't see it in the trailer, but if you watch the movie, it'll become painfully clear that when people were raptured away, their clothes stayed on behind. Kind of makes you want to think maybe you should lose a few pounds, kind of work on your abs, be sort of, you know, see? You see, the painful truth is that so often such ideology takes a couple of verses of the Bible and maybe a couple others that don't match so well and makes a point of it, makes what I think of as straw gospel. Not even a good news gospel, but something that frightens one kingdom of God, and that never leads anywhere. So again, this week, as I said in the last, I started all this because a good friend of mine, a 35-year-old Greek Orthodox priest in Dubuque, Iowa, named Father Dustin, he encouraged me to start reading this N.T. Wright. By the way, they study him in our seminaries too. N.T. Wright is one of the preeminent New Testament scholars in the world, and his book, Surprised by Hope, which I heartily recommend. Get your own copy and take some time with it. You'll need to read it more than once. I think I'm on time 7. And in that, we come to know more about what God has planned for us. So today, let's quickly turn to him and his teaching as he takes on the biblical story and reminds us that's where we always must start, turn again and again as we think about Jesus' second coming. Jesus came, and the Word made flesh. He taught, he lived with us, he went to a cross for us, he was raised from the dead for us. And then he ascended into heaven with the promise of returning again. Let's let Dr. Wright share with us his thoughts.
When Christians say the creed, as in my tradition we do quite a lot, they say at one point that Jesus will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And in my tradition, most Christians think, but I'm not actually quite sure what that means. What are we talking about when we say that Jesus is to come again? And so, for many people in the background that I came from, that was something that you said once a week or once a day, but you really didn't explore because you weren't sure how it fitted anything else or whether it even made sense. Of course, there are many other Christians, particularly but not exclusively in the United States, for whom the second coming of Jesus is the very center of all that they believe, and they have a well-developed scenario of how that's going to work out in terms of Jesus coming again, riding on the clouds, scooping up all his faithful people into midair and taking them off somewhere else. And then the story diverges into various other interpretations. But that idea of a rapture, a catching up, has caught up the popular imagination in a great many circles. What does the New Testament actually say about all this? Because, after all, that's where we go back to if we're going to make any sense of how Christian theology even begins to work. One of the first things we have to say is that all this is part of the big biblical picture about the kingdom of God, God's kingdom coming on earth as in heaven. And at the heart of that, the reason for Jesus coming back is that this is where the kingdom has to happen. That's quite clear at the beginning of the book of Acts, when Jesus tells his disciples all sorts of things about the kingdom of God. This is the risen Jesus, of course. And then he ascends into heaven, showing that heaven and earth are now joined in him, but then he sends his spirit on his followers so that they too can be part of this heaven and earth coming together movement until, says Acts, the time when Jesus comes again to complete that whole story. So that should frame for us the meaning of the coming of Jesus coming again after his first coming, his incarnation.
Working with the idea of the second coming is a big endeavor for one sermon. We'll come back to it again. But today, I hope to raise our awareness of the danger of certain understandings of all that and what it means for us as God's people. How this Left Behind series is centered really a couple verses of what we heard Liz read from 1 Thessalonians. You see, so often when the Apostle Paul writes, he wouldn't have imagined that we would have taken his ideas literally, but rather he was saying, this is what it will be like, this is what will happen. So in those short verses in 1 Thessalonians, the Apostle Paul is using three very interesting images to help us better understand what this will be like. The first is that of Moses coming down with the Ten Commandments to the rebellious people of Israel. The second is from Daniel chapter 7. In which we hear that the Son of Man will be swept up into the clouds. And the third, unexpected, is a thing that took place in Roman rule, in the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, when a ruler returned from battle or came back to Rome from touring the empire, the citizens would naturally and gleefully go out to meet him and then come back in royal parade. N.T. Wright does a better job of explaining all that well. But listen and understand what that Thessalonians passage could mean in the light of Jesus' second coming. Again, N.T. Wright.
The point of the second coming is that it completes the good news. The good news is God is sorting out the whole world through Jesus. So where does this idea come from about Jesus flying around and out and people being snatched up to meet him and going away somewhere? That's one particular reading of one particular passage in the first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 4. Paul says, since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, we believe that through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For, he says, the Lord himself, with the cry of command, with the archangel's call, and the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven. The dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. So we will always be with the Lord. Now, what is Paul saying there? Paul has a habit, like many writers, of mixing his metaphors. And often when Paul says something very vividly, he doesn't envisage that we would then take each bit and try and make one single concrete picture out of that. In the same way, though it's not so often noticed, that's what's happening in this passage, this famous rapture passage in 1 Thessalonians. To begin with, Paul is thinking of Jesus coming down from heaven like Moses coming down the mountain with the Ten Commandments. The imagery is there, the archangel's call, the sound of the trumpet. That's the first image he has. He sees Jesus coming down like Moses to sort out the mess in the people down below. But then he combines that with a quite different image, our old friend from Daniel 7, which is of the Son of Man being caught up in the clouds. Only this time it's not Jesus, it's us. And so he says we will be caught up to meet him. But what will happen then? Well, here's the third image. Paul lived in a world where an emperor or some great ruler might have gone away to fight a battle, to state visit somewhere else, but then sooner or later would come back to his home city. And when he came back to his home city, the citizens would go out to meet him. It would be a bit rude if they simply sat in the city gates with their arms folded, waiting for him to show up. No, they will go out. And what will they do then? Will they have a picnic out there in the countryside? No. They will royally escort him back into the city, over which he will then continue to rule and perhaps bring his rule to perfection. So Paul is combining the Moses image with the Daniel 7 image with, interestingly, the imperial image.
It's this moment in this series, these sermons, that I want to spend some time thinking about, so does this all matter? How important is this? I think it's very important. It's what N.T. Wright was just explaining, what Thessalonians explains. That's the day of resurrection, when you will be resurrected from the dead and you will be living eternally in the gifts of God's new creation. So stories like Left Behind and Rap worry me a bit because they take away from us three important things that are part of this biblical understanding of the second coming. They include these. First of all, the Left Behind story, I think, defies continuity of Scripture. When you hear an understanding of a biblical passage, a sermon, a process, how does that match up with all of Scripture? So this morning, when the children gathered here, how important it is for their pastor and for their members, their families, to tell them again and again, God loves you. That's the reoccurring story. I don't think this Left Behind story is in continuity with all of Scripture. Second, it creates a we-they mentality in our judgment of faith. Because, you know, I know I'm going to be swept up because I'm really good. I'm not sure about you, but you over there, you're going to go for sure. So right away, it creates a we-they mentality of judgment. It's so easy to slip into that. Listen to the news. Listen, some preachers on the internet. Third, it can make us as Christians apathetic to what God wants to bring to our attention. Because in this world, we now work for the justice that God will bring on the day of resurrection. But in this case, with the rapture, you spend most of your time calculating, counting years, looking at the internet, seeing who knows what about what, and you forget about your brothers and sisters in Christ, and all of creation. In other words, you become apathetic to the place of this world. Again, a dangerous loss for us as Christians. So in this, maybe you've noticed, I'm preaching upside down. In this series, I'm spending a lot of time in helping us understand some very important parts of our understanding of the faith, the centerpiece, and the resurrection of the dead, and then I read the gospel passage. It's an opportunity for us to listen with new ears in a fresh way. Today's gospel is from John 15th chapter. Jesus is about ready to be given over, to be crucified and put to death, and he again is thinking about you when he says this. So you'll find it on screen and in your folder, John the 13th chapter. When Judas had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so I now say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Today, then, this understanding of Christ coming again brings us new insight. Throughout the Gospel of John, we hear of Jesus being glorified, of God glorified, in what is about to happen. Simply put, in John, when one is doing what God wants, one is glorified. So you too live in that, you act in that, and you are glorified. And finally, on the day of resurrection, you too will be glorified ultimately, as God intends you to be as a human being, filled with eternal life, with for one another, in the gift of God's creation. So in all this, incredible ideas for us to help understand what's happening now and what will happen in the end. We live now as if it's already come, and that's why Jesus gives us this gift of love when he leaves us, that we share that with one another. Finger pointing of who's in and who's out. No wondering if you're good enough, but knowing in the gift of love in Christ, you are God's own. And God has great plans for you. So all in all, it is amazing, isn't it, to be that prized by the gift of the second coming? And isn't it powerful to be filled with, and be surprised by hope? Amen.